Engineering, ICT Mumbai. I take the privilege to welcome and wish you all on 120th birth anniversary celebration of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. As per the sayings by famous poet, Athanga Sagar Ekatra Karuni Shai Banavili Zari, Meru Himalay Karuna Lekhani Kushala Darudakari, Koti Vibhuti Kali Dasahe Lina Basle Zari, He Manwa Purna Bhimayan Kadina Hoiltari. Indeed, phenomena or miracle is the word that best describes Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Sometimes it appears that all historical and environmental forces were combined to construct this phenomena called Dr. Ambedkar. Right from his birth in Mahar military family to his getting timely royal patronage to the colonial contest to the unfolding circumstances that consist of political and environmental forces to his struggle, to his taking refuge in Buddhism and even to his last breath. So all these constituent factors appears together to construct him. Ambedkar Jayanti is an unique occasion for all of us to proudly celebrate the genius of the father of that one great book, which is the foundation of India, the Constitution. Dr. Ambedkar's parallel contribution in the framing of our Constitution and his vision, welfare of all, will always be recognized in the history of India. It is my honor to welcome you all on Oration Program being organized by ICT every year to commemorate the memory of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Today, we have with us an Indian economist, educationist, public policy expert, professor, writer, Dr. Ambedkar orator, and a member of Rajya Sabha, a very brilliant personality, Dr. Narendra Jadhav. Also, we are extremely grateful to have with us a legendary personality, divine scientist, and guru's guru, our guest of honor, Padma Vibhushan, Professor M.M. Sharma. Now, I would like to request all the honorable dignitaries to please come on the dais. I would request all of you to please join your hands to welcome today's chief guest, Honorable Dr. Narendra Jadhav. Guest of honor, Padma Vibhushan, Honorable Professor M.M. Sharma. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Padma Shri Professor G.D. Yadav. Honorable Director, ICT Odisha Campus, Professor B.N. Thorath. And Honorable Professor R.R. Deshmukh, Registrar, ICT. I would now like to request Honorable Professor G.D. Yadav to please welcome our Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. Narendra Jadhav, by presenting him a bouquet. Thank you, sir. I would like to request Honorable Director, ICT Odisha Campus, Professor B.N. Thorath, to please welcome our guest of honor and program chair, Padma Vibhushan, Professor M.M. Sharma, by presenting him a bouquet. Now, I would like to request Professor R.R. Deshmukh to please welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Padma Shri Professor G.D. Yadav, by presenting him a bouquet. Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to request Dr. Shalini Arya to please welcome our Honorable Professor B.N. Thorath, Director, ICT Odisha Campus, by presenting him a bouquet. Thank you, ma'am. Now, I would like to request Dr. Josna Wagmare to welcome Honorable Professor R.R. Deshmukh, Registrar, ICT, by presenting him a bouquet. Thank you, ma'am. We shall now commence this auspicious occasion by lamp lighting to pay homage to Lord Buddha and symbol of knowledge, Bharat Ratna, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. I would request to all the honorable dignitaries to kindly come forward for auspicious lamp lighting. Thank you, everyone. I would now request volunteer to play our Vidyapeeth Geet, Shri Rasayan Devike, which is composed by our Vice Chancellor, Professor G. D. Yadav, on occasion of Marathi Bhasha Din. Now, I would like to request Vinita Jadav, Sakshi Tempe, and Priyanka to please come forward and recite the prayer for Lord Buddha.
नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा सम्बुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा सम्बुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा सम्बुद्धस्स बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि संघं शरणं गच्छामि
द्वितीयमपि बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि द्वितीयमपि धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि द्वितीयमपि संघं शरणं गच्छामि तृतीयमपि बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि तृतीयमपि धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि तृतीयमपि संघं शरणं गच्छामि पाणातिपाता वेरमणि शिखापदं समादियामि अदिन्नदाना वेरमणि शिखापदं समादियामि कामेषु इच्छाचारा वेरमणि शिखापदं समादियामि मूसावादा वेरमणि शिखापदं समादियामि सुराय वेरमज्जपमादठाणा वेरमणि शिखापदं समादियामि साधु साधु साधु।
Thank you everyone. Now, I would like to request Honorable Professor B. N. Thora, Director, ICT Odisha Campus, to deliver his welcome address.
Thank you, Prerna. At the outset, I must congratulate Professor Yadav to institutionalize this Ambedkar oration about, this is about seventh year, sir. This is the seventh year that we have constituted this Ambedkar oration, where an eminent personality, expert in Ambedkar thoughts, is invited to deliver his lecture and interact with the students and let the students know about the legacy of Ambedkar and his contribution, overall contribution to the governance, to the India, to what the subject of economics and whatnot you can think about on the earth. Now the reason, another reason, it's a so wonderful occasion that I had this dream some time back of bringing together the two great personalities on the dais. And I was thinking about this for a long time. When I requested Professor Sharma, would you like to be join on the 20th, he instantly said yes. And here I would like to bring about some parallel between Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and Professor M.M. Sharma. Both this gigantic personality, one is the living legend, and other whose literature, so humongous literature, which I was reading for last 22 years. And yet, I can say that I have not yet known and understood the Babasaheb Ambedkar. Lot needs to be done to understand him. People say that the moment you read about him, your understanding of Babasaheb Ambedkar starts after that. So these two intellectually colossal people, Professor Sharma, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, both of them voracious reader, they are visionary leaders, and they have courage of conviction. So I'm happy that Professor Sharma is also part of this celebration. Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar says, those who don't read history cannot create history. तुमच्या विषयाचा ज्ञानाबरोबर अर्थशास्त्र, समाजशास्त्र किंवा कायदेशास्त्राचे ज्ञान जरूरी आहे. This is basically what he is addressing his students. What kind of students that he would like to see? What kind of scholarship that the student he would like to see? He says, माझे आयुष्य तीन गुरु आणि तीन उपास्य देवतांनी घडले आहे. This is what Ambedkar says. माझे पहिले व श्रेष्ठ गुरु बुद्ध हो, माझे दुसरे गुरु गुरु कबीर आणि तिसरे गुरु म्हणजे ज्योतिबा फुले. माझी तीन उपास्य देवतेही आहेत, पहिले विद्या, दुसरे दैवत स्वाभिमान आणि तिसरे दैवत म्हणजे शील. ह्या सगळ्या बाबतीमध्ये मला खूप काही साम्य वाटतं ते बाबासाहेब आंबेडकर आणि प्रोफेसर शर्मांमध्ये. ते अजूनही म्हणतात, स्वतःची लायकी विद्यार्थी दशेतच वाढवा. हे मुंबईतील आगाखान बंगल्यावर त्यांनी 1933 साली विद्यार्थ्यांना जेव्हा ती जागा मिळाली त्या अभ्यासकाला त्यावेळेस बोललेलं त्यांनी हे वाक्य आहे. कोणीही इसम आपल्या उपजत बुद्धीवर पराक्रम करू शकत नाही. जगात खुळी माणसे फार थोडी निपजतात. तसेच बुद्धीचा विकास करणे ही हरेकच्या हातची गोष्ट आहे. दॅट मीन्स यू कॅन इन्कल्केट दी थ्रू एज्युकेशन यू कॅन कम आउट ऑफ दी डिप्राविटी यू कॅन कम आउट ऑफ दी पॉवर्टी. 24 तासापैकी 20 तास सतत टेबलावर बसून काम करता आले पाहिजे हे बाबासाहेब आंबेडकर विद्यार्थ्यांना सांगतात. बिकॉज ही हॅज वर्क टू दॅट एक्सटेंड. मी माझ्या विद्यार्थी दशेत येथे व परदेशातही सतत 20 तास टेबलावरती बसून काम केले आहे. ज्या कोणास आपल्या बुद्धीचा प्रभाव वाढवायचा असेल त्यांनी तप केले पाहिजे, श्रम केले पाहिजे. आणि अजूनही ते म्हणतात ते हरेक तरुणांमध्ये महत्त्वाकांक्षा असली पाहिजे. महत्त्वाकांक्षेशिवाय मनुष्य धडपड व प्रयत्न करू शकत नाही. सो ती जिद्द असायलाच पाहिजे. आजवर माझ्याकडे 1000 रुपये पुस्तकाची खरेदी देणी आहे. म्हणजे ते म्हणतात की ही ओज 1000 रुपीज टू द बुक सेलर्स. असे जरी असले तरी माझी पत दांडगी आहे ती अजूनही गेली नाही. मुंबईतील कोणत्याही पुस्तकाच्या दुकानातून मी पुस्तके उधार आणू शकतो परंतु माझ्या विद्यार्थ्यांच्या कार्यात खंड पडू देत नाही. कारण विद्यार्जन हे माझे दांडगे व्यासन होऊन बसले आहे. विद्यार्जन माझे दांडगे व्यासन होऊन बसले आहे. प्रोफेसर शर्मा जेव्हा माझ्याकडे पुस्तक पाठवतात त्यावेळेस समजतं की माझा स्पीड काय आहे वाचनाचा. आठवड्यामधले त्यांची पुस्तकं जी असतात ती कदाचित मी 10% वाचू शकत नाही. पण हे जे आहे देर इज लॉट ऑफ सिमिलॅरिटी बिटवीन डॉक्टर बाबासाहेब आंबेडकर अँड वी आर ऑल्सो सीईंग द लिव्हिंग लेजंड लिव्हिंग द सेम लाईफ. There are a lot of things that we can say, but I wouldn't say many things. There are few things that I must highlight because the speakers are going to speak on the topic, very specific topic. In 1918, 80% people were dependent on agriculture. He warns, if the family planning is not done, and he was also supported by J.R.D. Tata and Maharshi Karve's son, that is R.D. Karve, he said, family planning is not done, the land will be divided and subdivided, leading to perpetual poverty. This is exactly what you have seen in the last few days. If you see the social political turmoil that is happening, you will see the various caste-based reservation which is coming up, poking their nose. Maratha says that we would like to have reservation. Lewa Patel says we would like to have reservation. Then Gujjar says we would like to have reservation. Now, the Marathas, which had the political power at time, suddenly you find them that they are in the poverty, they are languishing in the poverty. The answer lies in the analysis done by Ambedkar about 101 years back, that you need to do family planning, you need to take care of the agricultural. What he says further, that whatever the agricultural land is there, it should be till not more than 15% of the population. The rest of the 85% of the population must look into manufacturing and the service sectors. This was said about 100 years back. And it is how true it is that the society will disintegrate, and those kind of visionary statements, they are still applicable even today also. So those of you who have not read Ambedkar, please read him. And you can find so many of the things which are even relevant today also. Some of them are his submissions to the South Borough Commission in 1919, to the Simon Commission in 1928, Hilton Young Commission, his contribution based on which the RBI came up, Nehru Constitution 1936. I do not know how many of you know that there was an attempt to write the Constitution before the present Constitution. And so on and so forth. So unless and until you know the history of India, I do not think that, you know, you can really create the history. That's what he said right at the beginning, is that along with your subject, you must also have the understanding of economics, sociology, and the law at times. All right. So without going too much into his contribution, which Dr. Jadhav will say definitely, say a lot of things. His topic is very clear to you. I welcome once again to all of you for this wonderful evening, and have a wonderful time or a jugalbandi between two stars that are sitting on the dais. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Professor Thorat. for such an impressive words. I would now request Padma Vibhushan Honorable Professor M.M. Sharma to grace this event by few words.
Our great speaker this afternoon, Dr. Narendra Yadav, Vice Chancellor Dr. G.T. Yadav, Registrar Thorat, who has been taking a lead position in organizing this oration. First of all, I want to compliment ICT for creating this oration. Very well done. I think very well thought of also. We are going to deal with this great Bharat Ratna, incredible personality. It's very difficult to find a parallel to such a personality. Jurist, economist, constitutional expert, also a fellow academic. After all, he was in Sydenham College. So he was academic also. Now, if you look at this frightful combo of academic, economist, jurist, constitutional expert, you'll find very few parallels, not only in India, probably anywhere in the world. Extraordinary personality. And if you look at his life, it's a source of extraordinary inspiration. Youngest of the 14th child in the family, having seen all kinds of discrimination, rising like a sphinx, and architect of constitution. I invite you to see this coffee table copy of institution, our Constitution of India. I was lucky to have been presented by the then secretary in the Ministry of Cultural Affairs, and I thought it appropriate that it should be in the University of Bombay Library. So this coffee table book of Constitution of India is there. Those of you who are interested, please go to that library and have a look at this Constitution of India, how beautifully this Constitution of India booklet has been taken out. I did compliment then Secretary in Cultural Affairs that you have done such extraordinary job, and so nice of you to have gifted me. I want to dwell upon this extraordinary personality in a very different way, that he was willing to fight and perform. Sometimes people only keep on fighting but don't perform. But he fought and performed. And very few people know that he had opposed today's contemporary topic of Article 370. He had opposed quite strongly. And of course, he saw all the brunt of untouchability. It's a bit odd that his second wife was a Saraswat Brahmin. I think it was a very remarkable event that, having spoken against Brahmins, and very rightly, because Brahmins have done a lot of damage in terms of promoting untouchability and all, and he deserved all the credit for criticizing Brahmins and Manusmriti and all. Anyway, I join him in criticizing these kinds of discrimination. I still remember my childhood, and I used to end up in arguments with my mother. Why do we do this? So she simply used to say, to shut up. But not giving me an argument, counter-argument to tum bahut bolta hai. So I have also witnessed this, that how bad could be. But Bombay was always a good example. When I first came to Bombay in 1954, I found Bombay was a very nice example of practically no discrimination worth the name, what one could see in rural areas. Now, if you see the personality of this great Bharat Ratna, I mean, economics, then jurist, his mastery of economics was incredible. And that he could talk about economic policies, Thorat made a reference to his treatise on agriculture. More important, what is a very contemporary topic, Dr. Yadav will easily appreciate, that unless manufacturing goes to much higher level, today it is only contributing 16 to 70%, 17% to our GDP, it must go to 25. China grew entirely on manufacturing. Agriculture, although may contribute only 16%, 17%, but is exceptionally important from the point of view of welfare of the society. It is distressing to see what is happening in agriculture in India. And I was a bit surprised that although Dr. Ambedkar gave a lot of suggestions on agriculture, but if I'm not mistaken, he didn't make any reference to agriculture inputs by way of fertilizers and pesticides. Maybe you can correct me. But I don't think he made a reference to the utility of fertilizers. In fact, this got reflected in Government of India's policy. Most of you will be surprised to hear that we did not plan a single fertilizer plant all the way, almost 10 years after independence. Now you'll quote to me the example of Sindri, but most people do not know that Sindri was a war reparation gift to India because Indians had participated with the British in the Second War. So it was a war reparation gift. And Nangal came because they had no use for the hydropower. So they put electrolytic hydrogen plant, and by the time the plant was put up, there was no power available because agriculture had prospered. So they had only ammonia. They didn't have any carbon dioxide to make urea, so they made ammonium nitrate. And undeclared, it was supposed to be an ammunition factory. Overnight, you can turn it into ammunition factory and make ammonium nitrate of the explosives grade. So first systematically planned fertilizer plant is what is today called RCF, very close to us here. You can see from the top of the building the RCF factory. That was the first systematically planned. And even Pandit Nehru got swayed by the then Secretary in Agriculture that organic manure will do the job. How sad it was. Instead of one steel plant, if we had put five fertilizer plants at that time, the story of agriculture would have been somewhat different in India. Then we put three steel plants, two steel plants would have done the job, and one steel plant would have given birth to five fertilizer plants. But coming back to Dr. Ambedkar, the manner in which he steered himself, whether it was London or whether it was Columbia University in New York, is something to be very proud of, how he managed all this. And I am always surprised that whenever his photograph is referred to, he is always shown in the Western dress with the tie. He's not shown in the traditional dress. I never understood the logic behind it. Maybe Dr. Yadav, you will give throw some light why it is that in every picture of Dr. Ambedkar, Babasaheb, that he's shown in full suit and tie. Although he wore traditional dress. Now just imagine same person working so hard for Constitution of India. It is considered as one of the great things in the world, Constitution of India. Talking of economic policies, being an academic. Now imagine, there have been people who are scientists who became jurists, like even Nehru, his first degree was in natural sciences in Cambridge and then he went to law. So there are many combinations, but combination which Dr. Ambedkar had very, very few parallels globally. And I like to pay my tributes to this great son of India, who was very aptly honored, although posthumously, as Bharat Ratna. May I once again pay my tributes, and I will eagerly look forward to listening to Dr. Yadav. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such enlightening words. Now, I would like to request our Vice Chancellor, Padma Shri Professor G.D. Yadav, to introduce our today's speaker.
Dr. Narendra Yadav, Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, the Chief Guest and the Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar orator for this year, Padma Vibhushan Professor M.M. Sharma, Professor Bhaskar Thorat, Professor R.R. Deshmukh, Shri Dinesh Jadhav, brother of Dr. Jadhav, and it was a pleasure meeting you, sir, today. After a long time, you had helped me in removing of the hutments on the footpath. So I remember that almost 20 years back, maybe more than that, 25 years now. So you are here. My colleagues, invited guests, dear students, ladies and gentlemen. We started this Bharat Ratna Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar oration series a few years back, thinking that it is not just to celebrate his birthday on 14th of April every year and garland his photo and just disappear and enjoy the holiday. We said there is something beyond that which our generation should know, what Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar did for this great country and why he should be remembered and what are his thoughts, and can we learn something in today's society which is highly divided and bring some great speakers from across the country to ICT and listen to them. Ladies and gentlemen, so this is an attempt. Every year we do that. Around the same time, after 14th April, we invite one of the great scholars from India to talk to us about, you know, any subject under the sun. Need not be exactly on Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, but could be related to society, science, and economics at large. So today we are really fortunate to have Dr. Narendra Jadhav, who is a great personality in himself. And whenever I meet him, I bump into him sometimes at airport and here and there. We always have this great smile on his face. And he has been a friend of ICT. So Dr. Jadhav, welcome to ICT. And I must introduce to you for the public who do not know. I'm sure that everybody knows him, but for sake of protocol, I must introduce you to the audience. He has an outstanding professional career of more than four decades in public service. And he was member of Planning Commission, member of National Advisory Council, and before that, Vice Chancellor of the Pune University. And he served as Chief Economist of Reserve Bank in India. Having educated in Mumbai, BSc Statistics and Economics, MSc MA Economics with distinction, then received his PhD in Economics from Indiana University in USA, and he also received the award for outstanding contribution to economic theory for the PhD dissertation. And he was honored with the Best International Student Award by the Indiana University. So since 2016, April 28, he has been the member of Rajya Sabha. He has been also visiting professor at Ashoka University in New Delhi. He is an emeritus professor of public policy in MIT School of Government, Pune. He is the chairman of RBI History Advisory Committee, Reserve Bank of India. And of course, he is independent director of two companies, Tata Teleservices and Sustainable Agro-Commercial Finances. He has been celebrated public figure, having featured in Time, International Herald Tribune, and also Reader's Digest. He has received as many as 67 national and international awards for his contributions to economics, education, literature, culture, and social sciences. And these include four honorary doctorates, D.Litts, from different universities, and as well as the title of Commander of the Order of Academic Palms by the Government of France. Dr. Jadhav has written on Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and I must give you some glimpse. So he has written or edited 37 books, 13 in Marathi, 19 in English, 5 in Hindi, and has over 300 research papers to his credit, and also 31 official reports on a range of public policy issues in India. Bharat Ratna Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, two big size photobiographies in English and Marathi, published in 2016. Ambedkar, an economist extraordinaire, 2015. Ambedkar, Awakening India's Social Conscious, in English and Marathi in 2014. Ambedkar Writes, edited, Volume 1, Policy Writings, Volume 2, Scholarly Writings, and a Trilogy on Dr. Ambedkar's Speeches, which are edited, 3 volumes in English and 3 volumes in Marathi. And he has also added to his long list of publication a Trilogy on Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, and best-selling family biography. This is the pinnacle of that. That is, his biography in Marathi, Amcha Bap Ani Ami, having 199 editions so far, is the best-selling book in the 800-year history of Marathi literature. Dr. Jadhav, I think after Jnaneshwari, because 800 as a reference to Jnaneshwari, after Jnaneshwari, you have achieved this great feat, and so we salute you for this. And this book has been translated by in number of languages, 15 languages so far, and has won the Sahitya Academy Award for the Punjabi version of the book. So here is Dr. Jadhav, and we are all eagerly waiting to listen to him. He has chosen a very interesting topic, Gandhi and Ambedkar, conflict and compromises. Thank you very much.
Padma Vibhushan, Professor M.M. Sharma, who was very aptly described as Gurunam Guru. So, Guruvarya, Professor M.M. Sharma, my dear friend, Professor G.D. Yadav, my brother, Professor B.N. Thorat, Professor R.R. Deshmukh, distinguished invitees, faculty members, students, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a great pleasure, as well as an honor, to be here to deliver this oration, Bharat Ratna Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Oration 2019. This is the second time I'm coming here to give this oration. Last time when I came, I spoke on an economic subject, and that was chosen by Dr. Yadav himself. And that was something about the global economy and the future of Indian economy or something like that. And today, I'm truly delighted to be here again to address this august audience. And this time, the theme that I have chosen is Gandhi and Ambedkar, conflict and compromises. This is a very interesting and delicate subject. I'm very glad that Professor Yadav has given consent to let me speak on, share some thoughts on this very interesting subject when we are celebrating the 128th birth anniversary of Bharat Ratna Dr. B.R. Ambedkar when the celebrations are on. I'm going to speak about both Mahatma Gandhi and Dr. Ambedkar, and then I'm going to compare the beautiful relationship between them. You know, what has happened is that if you look in the minds of people, what do you find? Those who are Ambedkarites, they dislike Mahatma Gandhi and they accuse finger at Mahatma Gandhi. Those who are followers of Mahatma Gandhi do the same thing about Dr. Ambedkar? And it's never, the reality is never black and white like that. There are lots of shades of gray in between, and that's what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about the unknown, unseen aspects of their relationship. A lot of people know about the great fights that they had, but most people do not know that they shared a wonderful personal rapport and relationship. And that's what I'm going to talk about. First, I will talk about Mahatma Gandhi. Then I will speak about Dr. Ambedkar. And while speaking about, and then I will speak about Dr. Ambedkar and Mahatma Gandhi together and their relationship. And when I start speaking about Dr. Ambedkar, at that time, before I get into the subject of comparing him with Mahatma Gandhi, I'm going to respond to some of the things that Guruvarya M.M. Sharma has spoken here about Dr. Ambedkar in his very interesting opening remarks. First, about Mahatma Gandhi. Well, friends, without Mahatma Gandhi, the story of India remains incomplete. Without this Mahatma, the great soul, the story of India would remain soulless. When Gandhiji entered India's political life, he completely overhauled the state of Indian politics and its framework. He radically transformed the political goal of India's independence to Purna Swaraj, total freedom. Gandhiji held that it is the masses in the streets and people in villages who are the real source of strength and change. It was Mahatma Gandhi who dragged the politicians out of their closed door parlays and took them to masses. It was Gandhiji who gave Indian people a new sense of fearlessness. Gandhiji brought about a paradigm shift in Indian politics through introduction of what we now call transformational innovations. Those two, satyagraha and civil disobedience. Mass action through peaceful means became the basis of popular movement led by Mahatma Gandhi. The moral power of the people expressed in the form of non-violent actions such as satyagraha and civil disobedience bewildered the then British rulers. Once unleashed, the moral power of masses could not be suppressed by any force of power. It was Gandhiji who inspired Indian masses to resist and defy the power of British rules through peaceful non-submission to their unjust laws. No wonder even the greatest scientist of all times, Albert Einstein, paid the tribute, his own tributes to Gandhiji in the following words. He said, Generations to come will scarcely believe that such a one as this in flesh and blood ever walked upon this earth. Coming from Einstein, you can imagine how big and how important it is. What I personally like about Mahatma Gandhi is the so-called Gandhi spirit. And Gandhi spirit is captured in seven social sins that Gandhiji talked about. And these are something that everybody should write and should keep, particularly every politician, should keep in front of him or her. Everybody, in fact. The seven social sins that Gandhiji talked about. First one was politics without principle. Second, wealth without work. Third, commerce without morality. Fourth, pleasure without conscience. 5, knowledge without character. 6, science without humanity. And 7, worship without sacrifice. These 7 social sins can be translated into deriving 7 principles and predilections that were close to Mahatma Gandhi's heart. First one was search for truth, that is satyagraha. Equality for all, non-violence, Fourth is self-reliance or Swadeshi. Fifth is trusteeship. Sixth is inclusive growth. And seventh is sustainable development. Now, this is what Mahatma Gandhi stood for. He was the ultimate champion and the greatest commander of the Indian movement for independence. Let me now turn to a brief description of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. There, I want to refer to three points that Guruvarya M.M. Sharma, Professor M.M. Sharma made, and he said that Dr. Jadhav will throw some light on that. So I'm going to speak about those three before I get into my own narrative about Dr. Ambedkar. First one is that Professor Sharma mentioned what a multifaceted personality Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar was. And that is absolutely true. And he took the names of his being a politician, economist, and jurist, and constitutional expert, and so on. There are many more facets to Dr. Ambedkar's personality. Two I would like to mention. They are very important, and yet they are missed out in public discourse. One is that he was a great anthropologist. He wrote two very original treatises on anthropology. One was Who Were Shudras, and second was Untouchables. And he says in the preface, right. So he says in the preface that I have challenged the academics. Please either correct me, show me that I am wrong, or accept what I am doing. And nobody has done that even to date. That's one. Second, sir, you mentioned the point about inputs to agriculture. Sir, he actually did mention inputs to agriculture. He wrote only one big, very important essay on agriculture, and that was about the consolidation of land holdings. So while discussing the consolidation of land holdings, there was a question of what size of agricultural land, piece of land, could be considered economical. So how is economical versus non-economical defined? Traditionally, it was defined in terms of the size, that it has to be a particular size to be economical. Dr. Ambedkar said wrong. Whether a particular piece of land is economical or not depends on the coordination of inputs which go into that. So he did mention inputs, agricultural inputs there. Third one, why was he wearing Western dress? His picture, and everywhere we see him in this blue suit and red tie and that attire. And this is very interesting. Many years back, American chief of consulate in Mumbai, you know, we met in a function, and of all the persons, see the coincidence, he went all over. He said, I went all over Maharashtra. And, you know, I saw these statues of this gentleman, you know, wearing a blue suit and red tie. And of all the persons, he asked me, you know, see the coincidence. I explained to him then, and I want to explain it to Guruvarya M.M. Sharma now. What he was trying to demonstrate, that he is a global citizen. This was a long time before, you know, it completely changed. The Western influence completely changed. When he went in 1915 to study masters, he had a master's in economics from Columbia to 1915. He had a PhD in economics from Columbia University in USA from in 1917. And then he went to UK and he took up Doctor of Science in economics again from London School of Economics. See the top universities that he went to. And while doing Doctor of Science degree in London, he also studied law and became a barrister. So his basic degrees are all in economics. And Dr. Ambedkar was a person who did all these degrees, and his quest for knowledge was never over. Professor Thorath was absolutely right in comparing you with the, you know, in terms of the, no, in terms of vision, sir, and in terms of being a voracious reader, and in terms of being a knowledge seeker, I think he was absolutely right in comparing these two, one living legend and one past legend. So that explains the global citizen. One more area which Sir Dr. Ambedkar had really specialized in was he was an authority on comparative religion. There were very few people in India who could claim to be authorities on comparative religion. He was one of them. He had studied all religions in the world. Right. In 1935, when he made an announcement that he was right, absolutely. All the religions, and he could see the essence of all the religions. So that is just side remarks. Now let me come to Dr. Ambedkar, my own narrative about Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. He was undoubtedly one of the most illustrious sons of our country. Dr. Ambedkar entered the Indian political scene, socio-political scene in the early 1920s and remained in the forefront of economic, social, cultural, and political transformation of India during the closing decades of the British rule. And when India became independent in 1947, Dr. Ambedkar played a uniquely significant role in laying the foundation of modern India till his death in 1956. Dr. Ambedkar was a great social reformer, a valiant champion of human rights, and an emancipator of the downtrodden masses in India, who dedicated all his life to awaken the social conscious in modern India. Dr. Ambedkar's life is an incredible saga. Other speakers have spoken about it. I have myself mentioned about his degrees, so I will not go through that. Looking at his life, there's no wonder that there are more statues of Dr. Ambedkar than any other leader in the history of our country. These statues depict a stocky man, invariably dressed in a blue suit and a red tie, holding a book under his arm, which of course is the Constitution of India. Such statues are found everywhere. And it is also hardly surprising that every year on December 6th in Mumbai, in Shivaji Park, Chaitya Bhumi, 2 million Ambedkarites throng to Chaitya Bhumi in Mumbai to pay homage to the hero that they worship. It is also not surprising that in an e-poll, there was an e-poll in August 2012 about the greatest Indian after Mahatma Gandhi. This was an e-poll conducted by History TV 18 and CNN IBN. And to many people's surprise, the person who overwhelmingly was elected with more than 50% votes as the greatest Indian after Mahatma Gandhi was Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Some people in fact questioned that why was the question posed, greatest Indian after Gandhi? Had it ever been greatest Indian, we do not know who would have been chosen, but then it would have been a close tussle between Mahatma Gandhi and Dr. Ambedkar. Against this backdrop, you know, it is really unfair to see Dr. Ambedkar only as a leader of untouchables or leader of Dalits. That is how we are taught. You know, you will not find Ambedkar in the textbooks. Recently, there is a change. But over a period of time, you know, you will not find his mention. And wherever mention comes, it comes only as a leader of untouchables. Dr. Ambedkar was not simply a leader of untouchables, not even leaders of the only oppressed people of our country. He was a national leader, full stop. Dr. Ambedkar's erudition, his mass movements, his role in the government and outside government clearly shows that he was a patriot of sterling order. His brand of nationalism was quite different from others in India's freedom struggle. Dr. Ambedkar's nationalism was not confined to the transfer of political power from the British colonial rule to Indians, it was focused on a much broader notion of sustainable national reconstruction, that is building a democratic republic through creation of social equity, equality, and cultural integration in the age-old, caste-ridden, inherently unjust and discriminating society that India has been. In the course of his most eventful life, Dr. Ambedkar made outstanding contributions as an economist, sociologist, anthropologist, educationist, journalist, an authority on comparative religion, as a policymaker, as economic administrator, and as a parliamentarian, besides being the jurist who became the principal architect of the Indian Constitution. In spite of being a statesman and a mass leader, Dr. Ambedkar always remained a reflective thinker and erudite scholar. Even while being fully engrossed in the mass movement and political upheavals, he wrote remarkable treatises on economics, sociology, anthropology, politics, law, religion, and culture, which is truly a hallmark of a true intellectual. In all, he wrote about 22 books on various subjects, and at the time of his death, there were 10 books which were complete at various stages. Some of them were published little later. Now, let's talk about Gandhiji and Ambedkar together. Gandhiji, first of all, please note that Gandhiji was 22 years older than Dr. Ambedkar. In fact, Gandhiji had already become barrister in England around the same time that Dr. Ambedkar was born, 1891. When Dr. Ambedkar himself became barrister in 1922, Gandhiji had already emerged as a national leader in India's struggle for political independence. And they met for the first time, and I'm going to talk about that first meeting at some length little later. The place was in Mumbai, in Mani Bhavan, and the date was August 14, 1931. There is a backdrop that we must understand for this historic meeting. Dr. Ambedkar had known Gandhiji for quite some time, but he had no opportunity to interact with him. But he knew about Gandhiji and his achievements, what he had done in South Africa, and how he had assumed leadership in India after return to India, and how after the death of Lokmanya Tilak in 1920, how Dr. Mahatma Gandhi had emerged as a national leader in 1921. He knew all that, and he referred to Mahatma Gandhi as a great man. And when he had his, forget about the fights, we will talk about fights, but initially he said he was a great man. He said Gandhiji is a great man, and you'll be surprised, many Dalits are surprised when I point out that in the very first mass struggle that Dr. Ambedkar did in Mahad Satyagraha, you know, the only photograph which was there displayed everywhere was that of Mahatma Gandhi. Can you imagine? And when he was asked later, he said, before Mahatma Gandhi, no politician in our country has maintained that it was necessary to remove social injustices in order to do away with the tensions and conflicts. That is why he referred to him. On the other hand, Gandhiji, at that point of time, did not know who Ambedkar was. And it's very interesting how what happened. See, in 1930, the British government, decided, they had already decided to give independence to India, but it was a process that was being followed. So, what should be the constitutional organization of this country? To discuss that, they conducted what was called the round table conference. There were three roundtable conferences, first in 1930, second was in 1931, and the third one was 1932. And they called all kinds of leaders and representatives of the princely states. So there were, I think, very large number of people were invited. And first time, Dr. Ambedkar was included as a representative of Dalits. There were two representatives of untouchables which were chosen to participate in the conference. One of them was Dr. Ambedkar. The other one was a gentleman called Srinivas Ram. Now what happened is, for some political reason at that particular point of time, Congress boycotted the roundtable conferences, and therefore Mahatma Gandhi or Congress leaders refrained from going there. So first roundtable conference, Dr. Ambedkar got a free run. There was Congress people, nobody from Congress was there. And he made brilliant speeches in the first roundtable conferences, so which got worldwide attention. And that came to notice of Mahatma Gandhi. He was told about it. So Mahatma Gandhi, in the meantime, there was a change in the Congress position, and Congress decided to participate in the second roundtable conference. So in between these two conferences, when people were getting ready to go to England for participation in the second roundtable conference, Mahatma Gandhi wrote a letter to Ambedkar. And as usual, on a postcard, he wrote a letter saying that I want to meet you and tell me whether I should come to you or you will come to me. Now, Ambedkar was very polite, and Gandhiji was 22 years older than him. So he wrote back saying that, no, Bapuji, you don't have to come. I will come to meet you. So one day before Ambedkar took off to go to England for the roundtable conference, the meeting took place. And that meeting is very, very interesting. Dr. Ambedkar reached there on the appointed time with his colleagues, and Mahatma Gandhi was inside. And Mahatma Gandhi, for whatever reasons, it's not clear, but Mahatma Gandhi was also a great politician. He made him wait there for half an hour. And he was teaching a Swedish journalist how to do the charkha, this spinning wheel. That was not such terrible, of such great importance. But half an hour, he kept Ambedkar sitting outside. And Ambedkar was fuming, young blood. So he was fuming and fretting outside. Finally, before he could explode, he was called inside. So when they got together, opening line of Mahatma Gandhi, this is all documented. This is not a word is of my own. Mahatma Gandhi's opening line was, Dr. Ambedkar, I am told that you have been writing and speaking against me. I want you to know that I have been working for untouchables from the time when you were not even born. The immediate retort of Ambedkar was, all old people take refuge under their age when they have no argument to make. So Gandhiji was taken aback. He never expected this kind. And nobody had guts to talk to Mahatma Gandhi like that. Mahatma Gandhi was a national leader. So Mahatma Gandhi changed his strategy. And he said, you know, the other day I told Jawahar, that is Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, and we have decided Congress is going to spend 20 lakhs rupees. 20 lakhs rupees at that time was a lot of money. 20 lakhs of rupees for eradication of untouchability. So I have been, this is an area which is very close to my heart. Ambedkar immediately told him, Bapuji, all that money is not necessary. You know, it is going to go waste. All that you have to do, you don't have to spend a single rupee on this. All that you have to do is that anybody who is joining Congress as a general member, they used to call them Charana member, because Charana, that is a quarter of a rupee, was the admission fee. So entry charges or whatever, cover charges, if you may, to join Congress. So he said, all Charana members of Congress, you should take in writing from them that they will not practice untouchability in their private life. You don't have to spend any money. This is the rule that you should make. Second one, he said, every leader at all level should keep one Dalit boy or girl to work as an assistant in their own house. These are the things which will destroy the caste system. Not spending money like you are doing. That was not acceptable. And then the meeting went from bad to worse, and it really became very bad debate. And that at the end, you know how the meeting ended? Dr. Ambedkar stormed out of that meeting saying that Mahatmas like you are like fleeting phantoms. They only raise the dust, but not the level. And he stormed out. Now, imagine, this is a political suicide for anybody to say something like that to the national leader. But Ambedkar was Ambedkar, and he said that and stormed out. Then they met in the second roundtable conference. And in the second roundtable conference, you should see the debate that they had. It's unbelievable. They spoke to each other in a man, both Ambedkar and Dr. Ambedkar and Mahatma Gandhi both spoke to each other in the language of street fighters. And it's all documented. What was the issue? The issue was very simple. The issue was whether there should be independent electorates for untouchables or not. Gandhiji was willing to give separate electorates to Christians, to Muslims, to Anglo-Indians, Sikhs, but he was dead against giving separate electorates to untouchables. This was the issue. They fought, and very acrimoniously they fought with each other. At the end, it was decided, when the debate was inconclusive, it was decided that the final decision would be taken by the British government. It was left to the Prime Minister of England. And everybody came back. And Mahatma Gandhi was absolutely certain that he is going to get it his way. 4 months passed by. And then the decision of the British government came. And that decision, which is called communal award, that came, and it went completely against Mahatma Gandhi and completely in favor of Dr. Ambedkar. Now, at that time, Gandhiji was in jail, and he was in Yerwada jail in Pune. And from jail, he announced that now only Mahatmas could do this. He said, in a court case goes against you, then you say that the person who has accused, he should withdraw his case. So Mahatma Gandhi said that Ambedkar should withdraw his proposal for independent electorates. Otherwise, I am going to go on a fast unto death. Mahatma Gandhi 3 times went on fast unto death. On both 2 occasions, it was against the British government. And on once, it was against one person, and that person was Dr. Ambedkar. And that was the time when the whole nation turned against Dr. Ambedkar. Dr. Ambedkar was called traitor, and he was called names. And it was as if the life of Mahatma Gandhi was in his hand. You know, this can suit only not common men like men and women like us, but it suits Mahatmas. And finally, Dr. Ambedkar gave in. He gave in, and then there was a compromise reached, which is called Pune Karar or Pune Pact. Pune Pact. At that time, Pune was called Pune. Pune Pact of 1932. And then that pact was signed, where Ambedkar agreed that to withdraw the demand for independent electorates and agreed to having a joint electorate with reserved seats for untouchables. That is where Ambedkar lost the political battle. So what is the moral of the story here? The moral of the story here is that while intellectually it was Dr. Ambedkar who won the debate, politically Mahatma Gandhi defeated Ambedkar. And what has happened in elections until now is the result of that. that particular arrangement has influenced that for the rest of the our lives, even today. Now, at that time, there is an interesting side story there. When Mahatma Gandhi finally decided to withdraw, Ambedkar withdrew, and the agreement was to be signed, he suddenly remembered Rabindranath Tagore. And Mahatma Gandhi said, I want Rabindranath Tagore to be here. Rabindranath Tagore was 8 years older than Mahatma Gandhi. And those days, it was not easy to fly like the way we can now. But from Kolkata, Tagore came there. And Tagore, Mahatma Gandhi, when Tagore came in there, he said that, I like that bhajan of yours. Please sing that bhajan. And Tagore sang. And Tagore has written separately that I had even forgotten the words of my own bhajan that I had written. But whatever I remembered, I sang. And after he sang there, then a little girl was called. Now that has become standard with the orange juice. And that orange juice was given for quitting the fast. And what that little girl, by the way, who came with the orange juice? That little girl, I'm told, was Indira, Priyadarshini Indira Gandhi. So that was when it all came together. That was the beginning of their fight. After that, they had many, many other fights as well. What happened was, you know, they for a while after 1932, for a while they worked together. Gandhiji formed a society under Thakkar Bappa where Ambedkar was a member, but it didn't work out. In 1936, very interesting thing happened. In 1936, Dr. Ambedkar was invited to give a speech in Lahore. Lahore, that time, was a part of our country. And there was an organization called Jat Pat Todak Mandal, which invited Dr. Ambedkar to be the chief guest. And the subject given to them, him, was eradication of caste system. That was the subject given to him, annihilation of caste. And Dr. Ambedkar worked very hard and prepared a speech. He took everything very seriously. So he worked on a big speech. So organizers told him that, why don't you share with us a copy of the speech so that we can take printouts and distribute it to people. When they read the speech, they all fainted because it was a very strong speech. What Dr. Ambedkar had said there was it's a brilliant speech. Dr. Ambedkar, among other things, had said that you cannot destroy the caste system until you destroy the religious books which support the caste system. This was that he used the word that you have to put bomb to all these religious books. Dynamite, you should put dynamite to all these books and destroy them. Otherwise, you cannot destroy the caste system. So they did not like it. They said, Dr. Ambedkar, this speech is fantastic. But you know, you drop this paragraph, you change this word, you know, because people won't like it. Dr. Ambedkar said, I'm not going to change a word. Take it or leave it. They finally decided to drop the conference. The idea of conference was dropped because Dr. Ambedkar refused to change. Then what he did was, he published that speech along with all the correspondence that had taken place. See, truly a democratic guy. So he presented that, and that is in fact the best book that Dr. Ambedkar has written, is Annihilation of Caste, in my personal opinion. There are many other opinions, but that is a brilliant book. Short one, 106 pages original one. So that book was never published. So he published it with all those comments. To that, Mahatma Gandhi responded, and he responded very badly. Mahatma Gandhi wrote two articles in his journal, which he had called Young India earlier and then later on Harijan. In that, he wrote two articles criticizing. And it is surprising, now you find it surprising, that Bapuji actually defended the Varnashram Vyavastha, the Chaturvarna, the four Varnas. He defended that. He's saying that this is required for the stability of the society. And he said this is nothing but division of labor. So it is perfectly justified for maintaining the stability in the society. Dr. Ambedkar immediately retorted, and that reply is brilliant. You have to see it to believe it. Among other things, he said that, you know, I understand division of labor. It is the time-honored principle of economics, division of labor. But what we have in the caste system is not division of labor. Superimposed on division of labor is division of laborers. Division of labor is natural, but division of laborers based on the birth of accident of birth is something which is completely unnatural, and that has not happened anywhere. And that division of labor, superimposed on that division of laborers, is what the caste system is all about, is what Varnashram Vyavastha is all about, and that has done irreparable damage to India's economic system, to which Bapuji had no reply. Then there was another incident, very interesting incident, that Dr. Ambedkar, at that particular, when he made an announcement of changing the religion, Mahatma Gandhi made a very strong statement, and he said that religion is not like a shirt that you can change. And he said that Ambedkar is a man who never allows himself to be forgotten. You know, he constantly tries to stay in the news and he doesn't allow him to be forgotten. To which Ambedkar retorted very strongly. All this, you know, gives you an impression that look at this. Both great people, they were fighting with each other so much. Now let me tell you a story at the other side of the problem. Comes 1947. See, between 1942 and 1946, British, in fact, Ambedkar did exactly opposite of what Gandhiji was doing. When Chaleja was announced, this Quit India movement was announced 9th August 1942 in Mumbai, Goalia Tank. At that time, nation arose against the British. So British had a trick. What they did was they took some Indians and included them in the cabinet. First time, they did not call it cabinet, they called it Viceroy's Executive Council. So there were six Indians there and six British guys. And the six Indians included Dr. Ambedkar. That is when Ambedkar worked as an economic administrator. And look at the charge that he had. He was called labor member. That is labor minister. But that was not the only charge. He had labor, energy, water management, natural resources, and one more thing. So he had what, there are 7-8 ministries now, all that was with him. PWD, yes, Public Works Department, that was also with him. So, and the amount of work that he did as an economic administrator, sir, you talked about his being academic. He was not only a studious academic, he was truly an economic administrator. And he changed. Now, many things. I will just mention few for your information. Who started the employment exchanges in India? It was Dr. Ambedkar as a minister in the British government. Who started the water policy for the first time in our country? The Central Water Works Commission. Who established that? It was Dr. Ambedkar. In terms of electricity, he did a lot of things. Who reduced the working hours of workers from 12 hours to 8 hours? It was Dr. Ambedkar. Who gave women workers, industrial workers, maternity leave for the first time? None other than Dr. Ambedkar. We know all about it, but we don't know that the father of these changes is Dr. Ambedkar. That's our problem, because it has been kept away from people. So Dr. Ambedkar, 1946, everything was over, and they talked about forming a government. Dr. Ambedkar very much wanted to be in the government, didn't know what to do, how to go about it, because his fight with Mahatma Gandhi was colossal and everybody knew about it. And here is what happens. Now, this is not completely confirmed, but it has appeared in many sources. You see, at that time, the true remote control, the first remote control in our country was not Balasaheb Thackeray, it was Mahatma Gandhi. Nothing happened without his consent. So every decision had to be taken approval of from Mahatma Gandhi. So Panditji and everybody had to go. So when Panditji went with a list of ministers, you know, ministers to Mahatma Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi took the list, and you know what was the first question he asked? Is Dr. Ambedkar there? And Pandit Nehru could not close his gaping mouth because they were fighting every day. And Bapuji is asking, have you put Ambedkar in there? So he said, no. You know what Mahatma Gandhi did? He said, then I don't want to see the list. He did not open the list. He gave it back. He gave it back to Panditji. So Panditji goes outside, scribbled the name of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar in there, went in again inside. That is how Ambedkar became member of the first ministry. And he was made the law minister.
Law and justice.
Now, second thing, when they wanted to write the constitution of our country, this is really beautiful. Ambedkar, when they formed the Constituent Assembly, the Congress people had decided that somehow we have to keep Ambedkar out of it. So Ambedkar started saying there is no need for Constituent Assembly. But then finally the decision was taken to have Constituent Assembly. And Constituent Assembly elections were going to take place. And they were all given instructions that no matter what, Ambedkar should not be part of the Constituent Assembly. Now, this is 46 I'm talking about. So what Ambedkar did was, Ambedkar went to West Bengal, and from Bengal, he got elected to the Constituent Assembly. He was stopped here, but he, with the help of Muslim League, he went into Constituent Assembly. And then in Constituent Assembly, the very first speech he made was so powerful. In fact, Kaka Saheb Gadgil, who was the governor of Punjab and who later, who was the one person who gave up the governorship of a state to become vice chancellor of Pune University, that was Kaka Saheb Gadgil. Kaka Saheb Gadgil was the third vice chancellor of Pune University. You know what he did? Kaka Saheb Gadgil has written in his memoirs that we were all told to hoot out his speech. But when Ambedkar was a great strategist himself, when he spoke so effectively and so much in the spirit of one India that, you know, Kaka Saheb Gadgil writes that before we forgot that we were supposed to boo him or to hoot him out. And before we, when we were awakened from the impact of the speech, we found ourselves, you know, thumping on the desk in appreciation of Dr. Ambedkar's speech. And then when Ambedkar became the Minister of Law and Justice, and the time of writing constitution came, at that time, there was no chance of his becoming a member of Constituent Assembly, writing the constitution. Who gave him that job? Again, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru wanted an Englishman to draft the... You were the international jurist who was going to be invited. So again, with a note, Panditji goes to Mahatma Ji and says that ye samvidhan ke liye hum inko bula sakte hain. So you know what was Mahatma Gandhi's reaction? Kya aapko hamare desh mein koi aisa vyakti dikhai nahi deta hai jo ye kaam kar sakega? Ambedkar ji ke bare mein aapki kya raaye hai? And that, you know, asking that question. So immediately it was decided that there would be this drafting committee. Not only Ambedkar would be a part of that drafting committee, but that he would also be chairing that drafting committee. That is how he became the principal architect of the Indian Constitution. So the moral of the story here is that both of these great people, you know, it is wrong to see them in terms of black and white. And there are beautiful interrelationships between them, and both of them knew that individually they may be great, but the nation is greater than each one of them taken in isolation. And this is what the great people understood, the great founding fathers understood, and that is why Dr. Ambedkar could achieve for the country the way he did in terms of writing, not only writing the constitution, but defending the constitution. This is very important. You know, people like Arun Shauri have written a book, Worshipping False Gods, where they say that, what is Ambedkar's contribution? Everything was decided by the Congress committees and it was given to him. Yes, that is to some extent true. However, and that's where he upholds 370. The Constituent Assembly debates, by the way, is something that everybody should read. Just imagine 296 most brilliant people of the country at that time coming together and debating for 3.5 hours about our constitution and about future of India. You know, those 7 volumes are fantastic. It's a treasure trove of knowledge which everybody should read. Everything has been discussed, whether in the preamble, the name of God should be there. In the name of God, like there in the United States, there was a 6-hour debate on this. 6-hour debate on this issue. So there has been, you know, a treasure trove of information. Dr. Ambedkar's contribution is not only that he drafted the constitution, there was a team working with him. His real contribution is in piloting the constitution. Do you know that? Every provision in the constitution was agreed upon by consensus. It was not decided by majority. Not simple majority, not overwhelming majority, by consensus. So for every provision, Dr. Ambedkar would propose and present both sides, conduct the debate in the Constituent Assembly, and finally arrive at a draft which is acceptable to each and every person. Now, this was a horrendous task that Dr. Ambedkar performed. So, ignore what likes of Shauri are saying. You know, just go back to what the president of the chairman of the Constituent Assembly himself, who was the first president of India, what he said that for last 3.5 years, I have been sitting in this chair watching the work of Dr. Ambedkar, and I can tell you, we could not have chosen a better person for this job. In spite of his failing health, the way he has worked and worked so hard to create this edifice of the Constitution of India is most remarkable. So with that, you know, all that was possible because of these great founding fathers of our country. I always feel that while Mahatma Gandhi was Mahatma, a great soul, I think Mahamanav was Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. And there is a parallel in their life. Both of them worked in a way in conformity with each other to build the nation that we see. While it was Mahatma Gandhi who won the independence of our country, in one line, if I have to say, what is the contribution of Dr. Ambedkar? He created the social conscience of our country, of our democratic republic. That's it. Independence by itself has no meaning if it does not go with the social conscience. So they complemented each other at the macro level in the deepest possible sense. And that is why we must be grateful to both of these great sons of our country, our Bharat Mata. And I thank Professor Yadav and ICT to have given me this opportunity to come here and share some thoughts on a subject which is very close to my heart. And I thank all of you for your patient hearing. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful, enlightening, and informative talk. I request all of you, please be seated. Now, I would like to request Honorable Registrar Professor R.R. Deshmukh to kindly felicitate Dr. Narendra Jadhav by presenting him a memento as a token of appreciation. Thank you, everyone. An event like this cannot happen overnight. The wheel starts rolling weeks ago. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of very motivated and dedicated colleagues, volunteers, and professors. Now, I would like to request Professor R.R. Deshmukh to deliver a vote of thanks.
Chief guest of today's function, Dr. Narendra Jadhav, member Rajya Sabha. Guest of honor, Padma Shri Professor M.M. Sharma. Padma Vibhushan Professor M.M. Sharma. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Padma Shri Professor G.D. Yadav. Professor Thorat, Director, ICT-IOC, Bhuvaneshwar. In the audience, former Vice Chancellor of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Technological University, Professor Gaikar. Faculty members of ICT and dear students, support staff. It is my pleasure to propose vote of thanks to the dignitaries present here today for the 120th birth anniversary celebration of Bharat Ratna Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. To begin with, I am grateful to Dr. Narendra Jadhav, member Rajya Sabha, for gracing the occasion as the chief guest and also for delivering the Bharat Ratna Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Oration 2019 during today's function. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us on Mahatma Gandhi ji and Bharat Ratna Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. I am also grateful to Padma Vibhushan Professor M.M. Sharma for gracing the occasion as a chief guest of today's function. I am thankful to Professor G.D. Yadav, Vice Chancellor ICT, for all the guidance and support extended and also for introducing the chief guest for today's function. I am also thankful to Professor B.N. Thorat, Director, ICT-IOC Center, Bhuvaneshwar, for his support and for offering the welcome address during today's function. I thank you all for being present for this function. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Deshmukh. With this, we also come to the end of such an amazing, inspirational, enlightening, informative session. Before we all disperse, let's rise up for Vande Mataram. Thank you, everyone. Now we will move towards refreshment. Thank you and Jai Hind.